Mitakwayasin. That is a badly pronounced Lakota Sioux prayer that translates, all are related, or all my relations. Here in Minneapolis, there's an All My Relations art gallery that features work of Lakota Sioux people. On Indigenous Peoples Day, as we think about and reflect upon the gifts from the Native American cultures in North America, this prayer that I am related to all is a source of both great beauty and strength and also great mourning. There's a lot of grief in that prayer because as soon as we utter that prayer, those of us who are white, who are what the Lakota Sioux would call wasiku, who are the invaders, who are the people who came and took the land and drove the people from it, for us to affirm our relationship to all is to come into grief about how badly out of alignment, out of right relationship, we have stepped historically and even now. Indigenous Peoples Day started in 1992, the 500th anniversary of the landing of Columbus, the day celebrated as Columbus Day in the United States, which I know is also Thanksgiving weekend up in Canada. So happy Thanksgiving to those of you who are watching in Canada. And the interweaving for people in the U.S. between Thanksgiving and the Native American people is a deep one. So even though it's not Thanksgiving weekend here in the United States, still Thanksgiving and images of those original days come up strongly when we think about the gifts that we've received from the Native people. Steve Charleston, who's a Native American Episcopal bishop, and he was president for a while of Episcopal Divinity School. He writes a fabulous prayer blog. If you don't get it on Facebook, I commend it to you. But Steve Charleston talks about Native America as the Old Testament here in the United States, that the New Testament, rather than being on top of the Hebrew scriptures, is even more on top of what he called religious wars between the Christians and the Native people who were already here. And of course, part of the broken relationship is that the Christians couldn't see what was being practiced by the Native people as religion. I don't know about you, but the profoundness of that lack of ability to see is part of what I am mourning. I grew up, as many white kids in the United States do, thinking that Native Americans were extinct, thinking that it was too bad, but all the Native American people were dead, like the buffalo. That happened a long time ago. It was over. In West Virginia, no one ever mentioned to me that there were nations still struggling, still alive, still celebrating, still holding culture and language in life. It really wasn't until I moved out west and all of a sudden I started to encounter Native people who weren't wearing headdresses and talking to pilgrims, but who were in fact alive and contributing members of the culture, you know, there in Oregon in the 1970s, that I realized I had really been lied to. Not actively lied to, but lied to by nobody ever talking to me about something, lied to by not being able to see something. And for me, that is part of the mourning, is all of the ways that I have been trained not to see other people's worlds, not to see beauty, not to see human beings where they are there. Recently, I was reading a piece by a feminist scholar who was saying, I can't believe what I didn't see. She said, all these years I've been talking about those white feminists in New York around Seneca Falls, how they were so brilliant, so visionary, imagining women's full equality, imagining women having property, imagining women wearing comfortable clothes. And she said, I had read these documents over and over, and somehow I hadn't seen that these women weren't dreaming this up. They were encountering women there in the Iroquois Confederacy who were actually living those lives, who were wearing comfortable clothes, who were owning property, who were naming their own children after them, who were doing all of the things that those early feminists were, you know, seemed so, whoa, how did they ever think of that? They thought of that by seeing other people as human beings. And this scholar said, the only reason I couldn't see that is racism. There's no other reason that I could have read these documents, read what they said, and ignored it, discounted it. After we do see something, we can't unsee it. It's so hard to believe that we ever didn't see it. And yet for many of us of dominant culture here in the United States, in Canada, and in many other parts of the world, we have been trained not to see Native cultures, not to see Native nations, not to understand the complexity, the diversity, and all that was here long before Columbus landed on the shores. I have so many more questions than answers. Grief is only part of what I come into contact with when I assert that I am related to all, that everything is connected. Grief is part of it. Guilt is part of it. Even though you can say it's not helpful, it's still there. I'm still struggling to figure out what is an appropriate response to knowing that basically the land that I live on, the air that I breathe, the place that I call home was taken, in many cases illegally, from other people. How do we make peace? How do we find a place to stand? These are some of the questions I will be living with all my life. And a piece of that is mourning what has been lost.